of course, is speaking. And every time you see that, it's worth listening to. I remember an old commercial years ago, when E.F. Hutton speaks, everybody ought to listen. I got something better than that. When Jesus talks, you need to listen to him. Yeah. Say amen. Yeah. He'll never steer you wrong. I want you to read this with me. I said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches." I want to preach a little while tonight out of this scripture, but before I do, I want to go to the Lord in prayer. You can be seated if you will and pray with me, and I will try to deliver that that's Lord's put on my heart. Lord, I pray tonight thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. You say, "Preacher, that wasn't a very long prayer." Well, I want to tell you something. I said this at our home church a few weeks ago. Especially if you go out to eat with me at a restaurant, please don't catch up on your prayer life. Amen. Before we eat. Amen. Just go ahead and say, "Lord, that's good food. Hey, amen. Thank you for it. Let's eat." Amen. And so tonight it's time to get to God's table. Amen. And I'll tell you, if God's will is done here tonight, it's going to be a blessing for everybody that's in this building. I want you to look at this with me tonight. And all of y'all probably heard about this old knock knock joke thing. Y'all remember that? Amen. And you know, if I were to say that tonight to you, "Knock, knock," what would you supposed to say? Amen. All right, let me do that again. "Knock, knock." Amen. "Jesus." "Jesus who?" Well, that'd take me the rest of my life and eternity to tell you who he is. But he is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. And he's my Lord and soon coming King. But I want to preach tonight on knock, knock. Who's there? Amen. I want you to see in this scripture tonight something that the Lord's revealed to me. It's God's responsibility to do the knocking. It's your responsibility and mine to do the opening. Say amen. How many of y'all have ever seen that old picture? I had one on the wall there at home as a boy growing up in Southern Cumberland County. My mama had it right there where everybody could see it. Jesus is standing there and he's knocking at the door. You ever seen it? Well, have you ever noticed the handle is not on the outside, but the handle is on the inside? I just want to say to you tonight again, God will knock, Jesus will knock, the Holy Spirit will knock, but it's up to saint and sinner alike to open the door and let him in. Amen. I want to say to you tonight, I want to identify who he's talking to in these scriptures. You say, "Well, preacher, who is it?" Well, the Bible said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and if any man hear my voice," if any drunk, if any whoremonger, if any liar, if it, no, that ain't what it said. He said this. He's talking to the churches of the Lord God Almighty. There were seven churches back then in this part of the world. And friends, I want you to understand, the Bible teaches us that me and you can find our local church in one of these churches that's identified in the book of the Revelation of Jesus Christ. The church where I pastor, Mount Pleasant, Hunter's Chapel, you can find some characteristic of your church where you go, where I go and pastor, that'll line up with one of these or more of these churches here in the book of the Revelation of Jesus Christ. But he's talking to the church of the living God, or the churches of the living God. Can I just say to you, when somebody's knocking on a door, they're wanting in. Amen. Not only that, but they want your attention. Amen. And can I say to you tonight, I want you to understand this with me. There's a double application here. How many of us as preachers have ever used this same scripture to try to win somebody to the Lord? And we tell them, if the Lord knocks on your heart's door, let him in. I want to tell you, there's a double application. I don't think we do harm to the Word of God by witnessing to someone and asking them to open their heart's door unto unto the Lord. But primarily speaking, the Lord is talking to the churches. I want to say this real quick. There is an illustration in the 15th chapter of Luke where the prodigal son, here's one of those dual applications tonight that I'm talking about. The Bible said, you know the story, the younger son, he wanted his inheritance. The father gave it to him. He went in a far country. He spent it all. He began to be in want. But one day the Bible said he did what? He came to himself. Amen. And he said, you know what? My father's house, there's plenty to eat there. His hire, his servants, they're not wanting for bread. I'll go back home. And friend, listen, I'm not going to give you the whole thing. Just trying to make a point here. There's two schools of thought when we think about that very portion of Scripture. Number one, I've heard it preached. I've heard it taught. I've heard people say that it is a man that is lost without God, that has went out yonder in the world, and he realizes he's lost. And the Bible does say in that Scripture that he was dead and now he's alive. He was lost and now he was found. Oh, the other school of thought tonight is that it is a child of God that's got out of the will of God and got away from God. Can I just tell you tonight, it'll work either way. Amen. I'm telling you, either way, they're away from God and need to get back home to him. You say, preacher, what are you trying to tell me? I'm trying to tell you, brothers and sisters, there's no contradiction here. God's word is wonderful. God's word is inerrant. It has no contradiction. There's three things I don't try to do in my ministry and in my preaching. And number one, it is this, that I just run with any old crowd. Say amen. And number two, I'm not going to be a Bible changer. I'm not going to try to correct God. I'm just going to go with what it says. And what it says is these people, ever who he was away from the Lord. Well, something else I want to show you. Bible said in the second chapter, he's walking in the midst. I'm glad I live in a part of the country where I know what that means. I know what smack dab in the middle means. I'm from Bug Tussle. I know what smack dab in the middle means. That's what it means. He's in the midst. He's in the middle of the churches. In the second chapter, he's walking around. He's with his people. He's a blessing them. And the Bible said where two or three are gathered together, he'd be where? Smack dab in the middle, in the midst of them all. Amen. He's here tonight. Amen. Hallelujah. Well. But the Bible speaks of candlesticks. Did you know the Bible says that at each church, they were a candlestick. Can I just say this to you tonight? Candlesticks are important. Amen. If you don't believe it, you let a bad storm come through and don't have no batteries for your flashlight and your TV won't come on and your power's off. Hey, most of us have got some candles laying around. I want you to do something when you get a chance. I want you to go home, maybe tonight even, and light one of them up. There's something about a candle. When it is lit, when it is burning, it's giving light. It's giving off warmth. I'll get to the message in a minute. This is introduction. Say amen. But I want you to understand this. When that candle is lit, when it is burning, you can turn it to the left and the flame will point straight up. You can turn it to the right, it'll point straight up. You can even turn it straight down and it'll try to go straight up. You know what that candle's doing? It's a pointing up. Ha! You know what the church ought to be doing tonight? Pointing up, pointing to the Lord. Get people's eyes off our buildings and our programs and what we think we are and how good we are. It ain't about you. It ain't about me. It's about Him. Hallelujah. Oh, I hear so much about, look what we got. Look how much money we got in the bank. I'll tell you, folks, that ain't what it's about. It's about the Lord. And when the candlestick is burning and when she's on fire, I'll guarantee you the church will be pointing in the direction of glory and in the direction of the Lord. I'm telling you, it's through the church of the living God that people are saved. You ever heard that old term, channels of the church? Ain't nobody ever been saved apart from the channel of the church. You say, preacher, I wasn't saved at church. I wasn't either. I was saved in a little Jim Walter house on top of Bug Tussle Mountain 40 plus years ago. But here is my point. I got news for you, honey. You might say, well, I got saved listening to a preacher on the radio, on the television. Well, let me just tell you something. Somebody in the church bought the time. I got saved when I found a gospel tract somewhere and I read it and the Holy Ghost convicted me and I got saved. Somebody in the church bought it. Somebody in the church of the living God, a Christian, sent it out. My point is this, praise God, this world that's in darkness tonight can't do without the candlesticks in every community. Woo! You can do without your community center. You can do without your favorite football team. God, in Alabama, did I say that? I'll tell you something we can't do without. It's an old-fashioned, Holy Ghost-led church. Amen, that believes God is still God. No matter who's in the White House, brother, he's still on the throne. Woo! That's enough to shout over tonight. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and that'll never change. Well, glory, I got to get to the message. He's walking around in the second chapter in the midst of the churches. He's with them. But in the third chapter, he's on the outside knocking on the door. Oh, you say, preacher, where are you going with this? Well, just stay tuned. I want you to know something had to run him off. Something had to move him out, or he would have still been in the midst of the churches. Can I tell you what I'm driving at tonight? Many of our local churches, amen, are trying to function and trying to do what God would have them to do without the Lord's presence, without the Lord's leadership, without the Lord's spirit. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, I go to places, listen to me, where I don't feel the spirit of God one iota. I go to places where, brothers and sisters, I'd rather been choked on peanut butter and 50 mile from water than to been there. But I love to go to a hotbed. Whoop, hallelujah, where the Holy Ghost is real and the fires are burning and people are shouting and people are singing and people and the man of God has freedom to preach. That's where I want to be. Whoop. Now I'm afraid to get down there. I'm afraid I won't get back. Amen. Can I tell you? Years ago, I was preaching in a church sort of similar to this, but they had some fences like this and like that and one over here and some down that side and some down that side. And I noticed while I was preaching, kind of like I am tonight, little girl saying something to her mama at the church. I said, what that little thing of yours said to you while I was preaching? She said, mama, what are we going to do if he gets out? Amen. Can I just tell you tonight, I'm in. Hallelujah. But I want to give you why the Lord's on the outside and a knocking, wanting in. Number one, some of them had left their first love. And I just say to you, in old country language, they had got over it. I run into a lot of people, it seemed to me, after they said they've been saved for X number of years. But friends, it seemed like they've got over it, Brother Heath. It seemed like what happened to them years ago, it's not that real to them anymore. Do you remember the night? Do you remember the day or the place where the Lord saved you? Wasn't it a wonderful time? Didn't you feel cleaner then than you ever have in your life? Didn't you feel close to God as much as you could possibly be? Woo! I remember. I'll never forget it. I've never got over it. I'm telling you tonight, but ladies and gentlemen, a lot of folks have left their first love. He ain't number one no more. It's this, it's that. It's the job. It's the game. Amen. It's that over yonder. It's anything but him being number one on top of a totem pole. I thought about Henry and Henrietta. They're driving down the road. And one day, Henrietta's sitting all the way over yonder on the other side of the car. And she looks over at Henry and she just burst into tears. And Henry looks at her and said, "Henry, Andrew, what in the world's wrong with you?" She said, "Oh, Henry, when we first got married, well, I almost sat in your lap when we was driving down the road, and now I'm all the way over here on the other side." Henry said, "Well, Henrietta, I'm still sitting where I've always sat. Guess who's moved?" Say amen. Can I tell y'all something tonight? I want you to know God's word said, "I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll go with you all the way, even to the end of the earth." And tonight, if there's any moving, if there's any leaving done, it'll be on your part and my part and not his part. He'll never leave us. Thank you, Lord. I didn't have that wrote down nowhere. Oh, glory. Y'all remember, guys, when you first started dating, you that are married, you remember back them days? Paul, can you still remember that? Been a while, ain't it? Well, you remember how it was. You said, "Well, now, Mary Jo, I'm coming by to get you about 7. And he shows up at 6:30. You won't know why. He couldn't wait to get there. He couldn't wait to see her again. Amen? Same way with me and Miss Beverly back there. I'm telling you, when I first saw her, I thought that's the prettiest woman I've ever seen. I told the Lord, I said, "Lord, I don't know what you got in mind for me. I'm lost. I know you ain't even hearing this prayer probably, but if it's any way possible, I want to be her husband. I want her to be in my life." And I'm telling you, brother, I'd go pick her up. Y'all have heard me say this before, but I'm going to say it again. I went to pick her up, and time after time, I'd run around on the other side, and I'd open the door, and I'd say, "Beverly, oh, sweetie, get in and let's go." Oh, but about 2 or 3 years ago, she said, "Now, brother, listen, Junior," said, "I just want to know something. When we was a dating, you'd go around, open the door. You was so sweet, honey, wouldn't melt in your mouth." And said, "Now, that's 10 miles down the road before I can get both feet in. What's happened to us?" I tell you what'll happen. All you that are thinking about getting married, think about this. And just think about it. I saw this not long ago at a church where we pastor. Here come this young couple in. They hadn't been married but just 2 or 3 years, and they've already got 2 kids. And when they come in, they're carrying 4 diaper bags. Amen. And they come in, and all the way to church, they probably fussed and fought and, amen, and bickered. And they come in, and the song director happened to be singing, "We'll All Be Happy Over There." And they look at one another and say, "Yeah, but I want to be happy down here." Amen. I just want to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, when marriage comes, it's not all roses. It's not all just every time and every day just sweet, sweet this and sweet that. But if you really love one another, you'll stick it out. Ooh. Oh, glory. Thank you, Jesus. I want to say this to you. I mentioned that not long ago somewhere, one revival I think here in Yonder. There's a deacon come up to me at the church and said, "Brother, I want you to know I still open the door for my wife." I said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah, it ain't my fault she still gets in on the wrong side." Yeah. Amen. I think that old boy had it all mixed up there. I just say to you, you know as well as I do, when we first meet and we start dating, and back yonder years ago they called it sparking, whatever you want to call it. Now they call it hooking up. I don't know, but I just want to say to you, when you do find that special person, it's a special time in your life. But as time goes on and things happen, well, at some time it seemed like the love, amen, and all that we ought to have, it sort of wanes. And it's not as strong as it used to be or ought to be. Can I tell you, there's a lot of folks treat the Lord that way and worse. And if they'll treat the church like I've seen some of them treat the church, and if they'll treat the pastor like some of them treat the pastor, they'll surely treat Jesus like that. I talked to an old boy the other day. He's from up in the Carolinas. We did a camp meeting, and this is what he said. I said, "How y'all doing up there in y'all's church, that church where you're pastor?" He said, "Pretty good, but I'm fixing to sue the church." I said, "You fixing to do what?" He said, "I'm going to sue the church." I said, "Why, on what ground?" "Non-support." Huh? I just want to tell you, if you love your pastor, if you love your church, and the church is not this building, but it's the people, and if you love them, I want to tell you something. You ought to meet up with them and be with them every chance you can and love on them and let them love on you. Listen to me, ladies and gentlemen. One of the problems here in the book of the Revelation of Jesus, some of these people had left their first love. I got to hurry. Number two, they had just took in false religions among them. Oh, I've never in my life, in the 40 plus years I've been preaching and pastoring, have I seen so much false religion in the day in which we live. Hey, you ought to thank God you live where you do. Amen. You ought to thank God you go to church where you do. Yeah. I just want to tell you, I do. I thank the Lord for the church where we pastor and where we go. I could have been raised in a Mormon bunch, but I was raised around a bunch of God-loving, Jesus-loving, Holy Ghost, amen, people that love the Lord. But I'm telling you, false religion is all around us. It's on the left. It's on the right. But I want to say to you, I look at this scripture, and God's Son sends two letters and says, listen, you welcome in something among you that shouldn't be there. Whoa, glory. Somebody told me not long ago, said, preacher, it really don't mean a thing or matter that much what we believe. I said, who told you that? The devil? It does matter what we believe. It does matter what we believe this book says. I just want to say, I'll show you how much it matters. It's the difference in light and darkness. It's the difference in heaven and hell. It's the difference in up and down. I want to say here tonight, it does matter. This false religious crowd that's going from place to place and doing whatever, I'm telling you, you better know this book. You better know the Lord, and you better have His Spirit and a discerning spirit to know which is of the Lord and which is of the devil. Lady called me a few years ago, 1:00 in the morning. I said, 1 a.m. And she called. She'd been going to church where we go. Pastor at Bremen Baptist Church there. And she called and said, preacher said, something wrong with me. I said, I thought you told me when you first started coming to church about a year ago, you was a Christian. Well, I thought it was. But since I've been going to church there where y'all are and hearing you preach, I ain't sure no more. I said, why is that, honey? Tell me why. She said, well, number one, you use phrases like, you must be born again. Got to be saved by grace. Woo! I said, you mean to tell me you went to these other churches, Baptist churches, and you never heard about being born again and saved by grace and washed in the blood or being in Holy Ghost conviction? She said, that's another that bothers me when you say that. I said, well, what in the world? She said, I don't know. That may be what's wrong with me tonight. Amen. And we just kept on talking and talking, and finally she said, I figured it out. I ain't ever been saved. I'm lost. I'm headed to hell. Would you pray for me? I said, I sure will. You just come on to church Sunday morning. We'll just get. She said, I can't wait that long. I said, well, Wednesday night before Sunday. She said, I can't wait that long. I said, what you want me to do? She said, pray right now. And on the phone, I prayed for her. She prayed. I heard her. Oh, God, help me. Oh, Lord, save me. Oh, God, tonight, oh, would you please do a miracle in my life? I said, well, how is it? What happened? I couldn't hear nothing. I said, are you still there? And I thought I heard somebody running through the house. And in a little bit, I said, hello, hello, hello. And finally, she come back and picked the phone up and said, whoop, hallelujah, I just got saved. I just had to run around a little bit. But I'm back and I'm saved. I want to tell you, folks, this false religion stuff is sending people to hell. We better tell them about the Lord. Oh, pledge so much, and you can join my church. That reminds me of the lady that she went to join and join and join. They wouldn't let her join. They wouldn't let her join. Said, you got to pledge so much. And said, oh, but preacher, I want to be a member of this church so bad, so bad, so bad. He said, well, I want you to do this, honey. I want you to go home, and I want you to pray about this and talk to Jesus about it. Well, here she come back the next Sunday. She walked right up in front and said, I want to join the church. He said, I thought I told you to talk to Jesus. She said, I did. And he said, he's been trying to get in this church for years and ain't made it yet either. Find you a good church, a gospel preaching church. I believe you're in one, but I'm here to tell you a lot of folks are being duped, amen, by the devil and his crowd. But I'm here to tell you, as I look at this scripture, I realize this. There were people, brothers and sisters, that was just believing about anything. Now, I just want to say something to you. I ain't got no degrees. I'm not a doctor. I am an intern. Somebody asked me a while back, what's intern do? I said, I clean up the mess the doctors make. Say amen. And a lot of messes being made. It ain't just because of education. It's because of a lack of knowledge of the Spirit of Almighty God. And here in the service tonight, can I just tell you what the Lord has told me? I don't care if you're Dr. Digger. I don't care if you Super Sam the Saint. If you ain't got the Holy Ghost in your life and upon your ministry, you're wasting your time. Oh, there'll be places where you'll run into that you wish you'd never seen it. If God ain't in it. False religion was embraced by some of these people in this church. Not only that, but some of them swallowed the bait of dead religion. Hook, line, and sinker. Trailer, boat, and all. Amen? Amen. You say, what do you mean? What in the world do you mean by that? I don't know about y'all. I like to be able to play where it's lively. Amen, amen. I mean, I want to tell y'all something. A lady told me a while back, said, I got to preaching like I am. And she said, well, I just tell you, Brother Garman, I just feel like we ought to have dignified services and not be so rowdy and just calm down. And amen. I said, you know, honey, the last time I seen somebody like that, well, it was a corpse. Hey, man, you say, well, I go to places all over this country, and I'm going to tell you what, I look out in the audience, and I look in the faces of people, brother, they look like they just fell out of the back of a hearse. Say amen. Amen. I'm telling you, when you come to God's house, be alive. Be alive out yonder in the world, too, brothers, before the world. But when we come into God's house, may we be lively. Amen. That don't scare me, brother, raising that hand. I'll tell you, don't scare me. Somebody is shouting over yonder. I'll tell you what scares me when they don't raise their hand, when they don't shout it out. That bothers me. Hey, old boy, I was preaching in our home church last night, revival meeting, every Sunday night in October. He got up and he's preaching about how the church ought to be visible, how the church ought to be without variance and don't change from this old book. And he wound up and said, we ought to be vibrant. I didn't even know what I was till he come over and preach. I'm vibrant. I'm alive. I won't tell you, we don't serve a dead God. We serve a live Savior and a live God. Amen. Jesus said, I'm alive. Amen. And he said, I'm alive forevermore. And he said, because I live, ye shall live also. But when that preacher said that last night, you know what I said? I said, I've always said, a church alive is worth the drive. Amen. Amen. Y'all don't have all this old cold stuff. You don't have all this old frosty, the snowman religion. I've been to places where it seemed like it's so cold. It's Jack Frost was the pastor. You look out in the audience and some were cold and a few were frozen. I don't like that. You say, preacher, everybody got to act like you do? I didn't say that. But if you might try it sometime, you might like it. Whoop, hallelujah. I told this little boy not long ago, he said he wasn't bad to shout or good to shout, either want to raise a hand or even open his mouth while the preacher was singing or nothing. Just nothing ever moved him. I said, you need to practice up down here. He said, why is that? I said, where you're headed, if you're saved, it's going to be singing and shouting forever. Amen. I said, you better practice up. And I tell you what, I told him, I said, I tell you what I want to do someday when we get over yonder to heaven. Amen, and we're in there, and I'm already, if I get there before you do, I'm going to ask the Lord to let me stand over here in the shadows And when you walk through, and the first time you say, well, glory, I'm going to jump out and say, told you, is that good all the time? Say amen. Yeah. Or to be alive. Or to be alive. Hey, I'm telling you what, folks scream their lungs out at the ball games. Hey, amen. Yes, sir. And they holler and rant and rave when they hit a bad shot on the golf course. Why can't we come to church? Hey, amen. And let the world know whose side we're on. Amen. Well, glory. Dead religion. Last Easter over to church where we pastor, we had a lot of CEOs with us. Christmas or Easter only. I told Beverly, I said, Beverly, all them folks we ain't seen in a year or so, you might ought to hug and kiss them because you ain't going to see them again for another year. I'm going to tell y'all something tonight. You really love your preacher. As I've already said, and love your church, and you love the Lord above everything else. I'm gonna tell you what. I just think you ought to show up. Amen. Amen. See if the Lord won't show up and show out while he's here. Say amen. Amen. You say, well, preacher, what in the world are you trying to tell me? I'm not trying to tell you. I am telling you. God bless your heart. There's a lot of folks that's just bought into this dead cold stuff, and I'm not one of them. Listen. Now, some of you women may get mad at me. If I mess this up, I'll fix it before I leave. I look at that and that's beautiful. Pretty. It ain't got no smell except the dust I just sucked up my nose. There ain't no dust in it, I'm sorry. But it looks good, doesn't it? Pretty. Beautiful. But it's dead.
Amen.
It ain't got a bit of life in it. None. I done pinched that stem there and ain't a bit of sap to run out. You don't know why? Because there ain't none in it. You know what keeps a plant alive? The sap. It comes up from the root system. Comes all the way up through the flower. Come on up here where all this beauty is. Friends, I want to tell you something where I'm, what I'm driving at. There's a lot of folks that look the part, but they're as dead as they can be in sins and trespasses. I can take this flower and I can put it here, right anywhere in this church. And when I come back tomorrow night or Wednesday night, if the Lord's willing, if I come back 5 years from now, it'll still look just like that. And it still won't have no smell, and it still won't have no sap in it. Now, I don't know about y'all. Ooh, glory. There's a lot of folks don't need much of this. I do, I don't reckon.
Come on.
Now, where I'm going with this is this. I'm not one of them one-hour Christians on Sunday morning. I like to stay for the whole thing. I don't want to miss a thing. Sometimes I get there real early. And sometimes I'll go in my prayer place and I'll pray and even practice a little bit. Hallelujah. Amen. This is what now I don't. Ladies and gentlemen, there's a lot of pretty things in this world, but a lot of them are dead as they can be. A lot of beautiful edifices like this. Now, I ain't saying y'all like it, but I know a lot of places that such a beautiful building and everything goes with it, but just as dead at 2 o'clock in the morning. I don't want to be a counterfeit.
No. No.
I don't want to be fake. I want to be real.
Amen.
You know what will make you real? Have the sap flowing in you.
Yes, sir.
And you know what the sap represents? The Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Whoop, hallelujah. He'll get you up and walk you around. Amen. He'll wake you up in the middle of the night sometimes. You say, where do you get all your messages? Sometimes in the middle of the night, the Lord will wake me up and say, have you ever thought about this? I said, no, but let's have it.
Amen.
You say, preacher, what in the world? I'm just saying, ladies and gentlemen, if the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit is within us, within our churches, can I tell you there'll be life?
Amen. Come on.
Right.
Amen.
One last thought and I'm through. problem back in that day, and they had made the Lord sick, nauseated. And Jesus said, because you're neither hot nor cold, you're not in there real good, or you're not way over yonder in left field, but you ain't out there and somewhere in the middle, just because you're lukewarm, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Let me just say this quickly. When I think about the mouth of a person, I think about that's how we talk. And I tell y'all something, I don't want to be spewed out of his mouth because I want to communicate with him.
Yes, amen. Amen.
Something else we eat with our mouth. By the way, I ain't had no supper yet, so I got to hurry. I'm getting weak. But we eat. Boy, ain't it good to come to God's house even on a Monday night and eat off his table. Hallelujah. Oh, glory. I read where the Bible said he just supplied dainties, good things to his people. I got a thought. I ain't ever preached it, but it's coming on down the pike. Goodies from glory. Amen. And I tell you, God will give us goodies from glory, and he'll spread the table. Hey, man, a table will be spread where the saints can be fed.
Right.
And tonight I've eaten. And I've been blessed. And there's one more thing about that mouth. Everybody look right up here, young and old, and I'm about through. You kiss with your mouth. Somebody said, how old are you? Ain't none of your business. But I still like a little kiss every once in a while. Ain't nothing wrong with me kissing my wife, is there?
No, sir.
Something wrong with me kissing everybody else's wife, but my wife. Ain't nothing wrong with that. Nah. You know why I like to do that? Because I love her.
Amen.
Oh, Lord. I want it to just stay where the Lord can just kiss me.
Amen.
Just kiss on me and hug me up. And when it seems like things are going so bad, it's good, talking about that community, it's good to hear him say, it's going to be all right. And when you get weak and you need strength, it's good when you just get a good T-bone steak out of the Word of God. And then when you don't know what you're going to do and where you're going to turn, ain't it good to feel his arms around you and love on you? I'm going to tell y'all something tonight. I'm glad. Oh, Lord, I feel him on me tonight. Somebody said, "Would you ain't been down here in years. Did you leave him down here and expect to get back with him tonight?" No, I took him home with me back then. He come down here with me tonight. He's everywhere I go.
Amen.
And when I need to talk with him, and when I need some good food from glory, and when I need a good hug and kiss from my Savior, my Lord, he's right there. And he blesses me. You can't see it, but I feel his arm around me. Well, glory, if he ever gets that real to you, you're liable to shout too. But the scripture said, and I'm through with this. I'm closing. I don't mean I'm through. I've been known to close for 2 hours. Say amen. One more thing. He said, if any man, now that'd be a generic term, man or woman, will hear my voice, I will come into them. And sup with them and them with me.
Yes.
And grant an entrance into my everlasting kingdom. Now listen real close, and I'm through with this. He didn't say the whole church had to do it. He didn't say every local church had to do it. He said if any singular person wants to do it. See, it's personal now. It's you and the Lord right now. Will you open the door? Can I tell you what one person getting right with God can do? I go on back under my great-grandpa. His name was George Garman. He got saved. He had a son, another son, but he had this one son named John Garman. And John Garman got saved. And he had a son, and his name was Otis Garman. And he had a son, his last son, his baby son, Otis Garman Jr., that's me. And I got saved. You say, what you trying to tell me? I'm just trying to tell you something tonight. It's when you just get one right with God, there ain't no telling what would have happened.
Amen.
Oh, glory, amen. Glory. And I want to close this, shut up with this. I'm going to be done. McDonald's are closed. Amen. Listen real close to this. Listen real close. I want you to get this. I started out with this fact here. It's a dual application. You can speak this scripture to the lost or to the saved. Either one, if the Lord's knocking on that heart door, just open it up.
Amen.
And let me give you this. At Bremen Church for 26 years, I went back down there to preach a revival. I preached 5 nights, had 5 people saved. One of them was my little grandboy, and he is 5 years old. And I got to think about that. That's a number of grace, isn't it? 5. It was a gracious week. But when my little grandboy got saved, he's 5 years old. You say, I don't believe that. I believe that's too young. Who made you God? Who died and left you in charge? I won't tell you what I do when little ones come. I don't discourage them, but I do not be overbearing with them. Amen. But if they come, I'm not going to tell them to go sit back down. I'm going to let them see if they can do business with God.
Amen.
This little fella come that night. I'd watched him the whole service, and he'd over there crying and told Beverly, well, I got to learn a new term today, twisting his eyes. And he was twisting them eyes, and he was tears running down his face, and then all of a sudden, here he come. He ran up the altar. He got down on his knee, and he said, Grandpa, Grandpa. And I said, what is it, boy? He said, come here, down here. I got down there beside him, and I said, son, what is it? He said, Grandpa, when you was a preaching a while ago, Jesus knocked on my heart's door. I said, well, what'd you do? He said, I let him in. Woo! If he knocks on your door, saint or sinner, let him in. A lot of our churches need to let him back in.
Yeah.
I ain't saying by no means that's the way it is here. I'm just giving you a warning. Don't let it get that way.
Amen.
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 Amen. Would you stand with me all over the house? Brother Sam, would you come up? Let's have an invitation. And maybe everybody here is saved. I don't know. Maybe everybody here tonight is right where they need to be as a Christian. But if you're not, would you come pray? And I'll give you something else. Brother Sam mentioned this a while ago about lost loved ones and friends. Do y'all know anybody that needs to open the door and let him in?
Yes.
Raise your hand. Let me see if you're concerned enough even to do that. Lord, I just pray tonight before they ever sing. Lord, God, wherever they may be, the one that's on my mind and heart, I pray that if you knock on that heart's door that they'll open it and let you in. Oh, God, they'll never be sorry of it. Oh, Lord, tonight, if there's people in this audience that need to come pray for these people or somebody that's on their heart, let them come right
yes,
now
as Lord.
We sing this invitation. Have your way, Lord. Have your way. Amen.
Amen.
All right. You know somebody you'd like to see saved? Somebody back in church that's got out? Somebody that needs healing? You say, are you a Baptist and believe in healing? I sure do. There's still a bomb in Gilead. Would you come tonight and pray if you need to? The altar's open.
Yes.
Come on, come on. Sing when you get ready, Brother Paul. Sing when you get ready. If you know somebody you need to pray for, need to pray for yourself, just come on. God, have your way tonight. Save my grandchildren. Save my son. Oh God, tonight, save that boy. Save Will, Lord. Oh Lord, tonight, save him. Speak to his heart. God, I don't know what's wrong with us over there. If it's me, forgive me. Oh God, I want to see him saved. I want to see these others saved.